What's going on, good people? Doing bad. Put up there so I can get some comments on this shit. Talk to y'all mind over this. Hello? I was sitting up here, just chilling, playing a game. When I heard you. Computer moving called brain games, and this is something that you can go and check out for yourself. I'm just playing it so you can hear it, because if I get up there and put the picture on it, you're probably gonna get up there and give me some copyright bullshit, something like that done. But I don't even know what's going on this on here, because I can't read y'all comments. So I guess just keep commenting to yourself, or comment, and I guess when I learn how to read, I'll be real. But until then, let's do this thing. Brainstorm. Good enough. You can even do stuff like this. They won't hit that piece of bullshit with me now.
First, if you want to learn how the devil is in the details and what it means for your brain, stick around. Compassion, the ability to understand and empathize with the pain of others, is all around us and is a hallmark of a truly evolved human being. On the other hand, in today's me-first world, empathy for others can often seem like a pretty scarce commodity. In many ways, it might seem like the people with the most success have the least compassion. So which path do you choose? If you have an extra buck, do you give it to someone in need, or do you keep it for yourself? The real answer is, it depends. Compassion can feel good, but not if it causes some hardship. So which is it? Is your brain hardwired to be selfish or selfless? We can begin to answer that question by taking another look at the image we showed you earlier. Are you able to see both the angels and the demons now? Odds are you can only see one at a time because your brain has to make a choice. Over half of the people we
showed
saw the demons first, while a quarter of them struggled to see the angels at all. Now, if you struggle to see the angels, it doesn't mean you're more likely to listen to the devil on your shoulder. But studies have shown
your helicopter will be with you directly.
It's LJT. Guess who I just spoke to?
So don't feel bad if you didn't see the angels right away. It doesn't make you a rotten person. Whether you're an angel or a devil, we're about to show you another way to train your brain to be more compassionate.
I'm gonna
teach you
to move
out
to my lightning zone.
Expert panel of babies. We're at Yale University with psychologist Dr. Karen Wynn, head of the Infant Cognition Center, to answer the age-old question: are we born naughty or nice? To find out, Dr. Wynn has created an experiment.
Settle in and relax. We'll get you there safely. Enjoy the complimentary champagne in the back.
And if they have a preference.
The babies we'll be looking at today are between 8 and 12 months of age. They are young enough that they do not yet speak language, but they're old enough that they can express their own preferences
and
given a choice of different options.
Walk along with our pint-sized participants and see if their young minds are wired for compassion. They'll see a not-so-nice puppy, a helpful puppy, and a cat trying to open a box. Nice one. Which one will you choose?
Green.
That one?
Sure enough, this baby picks
it's more beautiful up here.
So did this baby. This one too. And only a small percentage of babies
no problem. Enjoy the ride.
Parents are always pleased with the result when their baby chooses the nice puppet. We've been running variations of this study for a number of years now, and what we find is always the same. At all the ages we've tested, babies prefer the nice characters over the mean characters. Even at the very youngest
like
ages,
we can adapt. Babies don't know nothing but what they're taught to know, but within inside of them is everything to know. They got a heartbeat, baby.
Is released by the hypothalamus, resulting in feelings of caring, bonding, and empathy.
We used to think that compassion and sensitivity to the feelings of others were things that young children had to learn. But now, studies are suggesting that these tendencies may be part of human nature.
Being in the greatest creation of all, the conscious thinking human.
Over individuals who act in a compassionate and positive way towards others, over individuals who are looking out for number one.
So you might be asking yourself, if we're all born compassionate, why do we seem to act so selfish when we get older? But the real question is, do we really lose our compassion at all?
To help figure it out, we're going to play another game. Watch this animation closely. Afterwards, we'll ask you a question about it.
You know what we've got to do.
Ready? Here it goes. Volunteers. Let's see how your story compares to theirs.
The anger aggressive orange triangle, looking for trouble, see someone that he could pick on.
It starts pushing him around, being real mean.
The green dad looks like he's being attacked and is running away from the situation.
Yeah, the orange triangle is a bully. The gray triangle is a good guy. He's standing up for the green circle. He was even willing to take heat to protect the little guy.
Did you come up with the same story about the big orange triangle trying to bully the small green dots? Stop and think for a minute. All we showed you were a bunch of shapes moving around. They were simply triangles and dots and a few random lines. The fact that you and our volunteers assigned these shapes human qualities, creating a story about bullying with villains and heroes, is just a product of the compassion.
Okay, you've done the hard part. Now deliver those goods undamaged, and we'll get paid in full.
How hardwired we are for compassion is Dr. Jim Cohn, Associate Professor of Clinical Psychology at the University of Virginia.
This demonstration is known as the Hyder Symbol Test. It was originally created to understand how your brain automatically creates a story around random events. But psychologists have realized it's a perfect way to illustrate how most of us have a tendency towards compassion.
What happens in our bodies when we feel compassion is pretty amazing. Cutting-edge research has pinpointed a caretaking organ called the vagus nerve. No, not that vagus. V-A-G-U-S. The vagus nerve is one of the oldest brain structures. It runs from the base of the brain to the heart, liver, and intestines.
It's a meat.
And evidence has been found that the vagus nerve may be the compassion sensor in your brain.
Your brain is so attuned to recognizing suffering and unfairness that even something like the video you just saw can trigger your vagus nerve and your brain's response.
Scientists think this ingrained ability to be compassionate has evolved for one main reason: survival. Helping others and relying on the kindness of strangers actually helps you to stay alive. So our brains are hardwired. That doesn't mean that our people are equal to compassion. In fact, there are some people out there who totally lack compassion. The clinical term for a person who is devoid of compassion is psychopath. Of course, very few of us are knife-wielding killers like the movies. But But there are plenty of people living among us who do demonstrate psychopathic tendencies. And some studies suggest that as much as 1% of people in society could be psychopaths.
So how would you know if you or anyone you know has psychopathic tendencies? Well, it just so happens, scientists have devised a simple test to determine just that. Want to know where you rank on the scale between compassion and psychopathic? You're about to find out in this next game.
We're hosting a party. We brought these people in six partners to an experiment. What they don't know is we're about to test them for any psychopathic traits that they may reveal. This simple test has been scientifically determined to uncover psychopathic tendencies. If you were at this party, you felt a psychopath. What if the psychopath was you? Stick around and take the test for yourself. These people think they're here for a party. We're really here to see where they fall on the compassionate versus psychopathic scale. Want to know where you fall? Listen to the following six statements while we ask our volunteers. Keep track of how many of the statements you agree with. Ready? Success is based on survival of the fittest. You agree or disagree with that statement?
Agree.
Disagree.
When I get frustrated, I release my anger by blowing up. Agree or disagree?
Agree.
Disagree.
Love is overrated. What do you think?
Agree.
For me, what's right is whatever I can get away with. Be honest.
I agree.
I admire a really clever scam. Even just a little bit?
Agree. Disagree.
I tell people what they want to hear so that they'll do what I want them to. Agree or disagree?
Agree. Disagree. So, how many questions did you agree with and how many did you disagree with?
Want to know what your answers say about you? If you agree to one or two questions, you're like half of our volunteers, and you show high levels of compassion. But if you say you agree to three or four questions, you're like a third of our volunteers. You're on the borderline of showing psychopathic tendencies. Now, if you said agree five or more times, well, like two of our volunteers, you're more inclined to harbor some psychopathic tendencies.
I think I have to be a lot careful about how I act in public.
Don't worry. Even if you agreed all six times, it doesn't mean you're secretly a dangerous maniac. While everyone displays some of these tendencies, only a select few can be called true psychopaths.
Same with me, buddy.
Yes, I do have psychopathic tendencies. Date me.
Brains view the world very differently from the rest of us and have significantly decreased activity in areas associated with compassionate behavior. These questions also reveal something fascinating. Kids, when tested, the majority of the population shows some aspects of behaviors also seen in psychopaths, like superficial charm, impulsiveness, need for stimulation, lack of guilt or remorse, and of course, lack of empathy.
So if none of us are perfect or compassionate, it raises an interesting question. Is all compassion created equal? Even if you don't have psychopathic tendencies, would you help some people more than others?
Imagine one of these two people needs your help. Who would you be more likely to offer assistance to? Option A, a nice young woman. Or option B, Skull, your friendly neighborhood biker. We know you most likely chose the nice young lady over Skull. Why wouldn't you? Skull is pretty intimidating. But let's play again with a minor change to your choices. Same deal as before. Now, who would you help? Option A, E.T., or option B, the biker?
The biker.
We know this is a ridiculous choice. We're doing this to make a point. When faced with a creature from another planet, Skull doesn't look so bad, does it? So what happened? The answer lies in mathematical formula for explaining kin selection as a form of genetic evolution. But it could also explain who you'll be compassionate towards and who you won't. Sound hard to believe?
Scientists have known for a long time that we would like to help people who remind us of, well,
sometimes
us.
It's good, sometimes it's good.
Our ancestors assumed that people who looked like us were more likely to be relatives, and thus more worthy of our helping hand because it furthered our own genetic code.
What's this magical equation? Benefit times relation is greater than cost.
What that means is, the benefit of helping us times the relationship to that person must be greater than the cost of helping them, for your brain to automatically tell you to lend a hand.
Think about it. Are you more likely to help family and friends than a total stranger? Of course. The potential benefit is much greater than the cost if you help someone you're familiar with.
This is the formula that determines why we might be compassionate to someone else. The more similar someone is to you, the greater likelihood you'll lend them a hand.
All that insight in one little equation. Amazing. But what about growing compassion if it's not there to start with? As you're about to see in this next game, we brought in some volunteers to conduct a simple experiment to test people's compassion.
You're going to go this way and to the first door on the left.
Great, thanks.
First step is to check in, then sit down with our scientists.
So what you have in front of you is a bullet chill. It is going to be eaten by another test subject. That subject does not get paid unless he eats the entire bullet chill.
In this experiment, there are three hot sauce options. Mild, medium,
this is huge.
Participants can put as much or as little as they want.
That's a one-way mirror, so the test subject cannot see which you choose.
Gotcha. So what would you do if you were given this choice? This volunteer chooses the mild hot sauce. Seems reasonable, since the default setting for most people is to show compassion.
That's it.
But is there anything we can do to make mostly compassionate people take the low road?
Two lanes, man.
They say revenge is a dish best served cold.
Look at him.
He can't see me? No.
But in this case, it's gonna be hot. Putting these volunteers' compassion to the test by asking them to choose which of three hot sauce options they want to serve a total stranger. Earlier, we saw our volunteer show compassion by choosing the mild sauce.
That's it.
But now we're going to change up this experiment.
Good to see you, Bob.
And see if we can provoke a different compassion reaction.
First room on the left here.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Yo, two lanes, man.
You see that? This guy practically ran over our volunteer. As you might have suspected, this experiment consists of several hidden cameras. And everyone, from the receptionist to the scientist and the loud obnoxious guy, are in on it. Now let's see which hot sauce this volunteer picks.
So what you have in front of you is a bowl of chili.
It's the same experiment as before, deciding which hot sauce to feed a total stranger. And now, it's time for our volunteer to meet this guy.
And that is a one-way mirror. The subject cannot see.
Okay.
Please proceed.
So what would you do if some guy just ran you over and didn't even apologize?
Two lanes, man.
You do
would you
know
seek
that
revenge?
I've got 2 degrees.
Remember, he can't see you. So would you go with mild, medium, or death? Wow, with no hesitation, this guy is adding a lot of death sauce. Looks like he's throwing compassion right out the window. And he wasn't the only one.
We're good to go.
Watch where you're going.
Death it is again.
Gotta steal with my...
And left to their own devices, most people are compassionate by default. But as soon as they feel slighted, they immediately warrant justice. Just like when some jerk cuts you off in traffic, your brain goes into revenge mode, wishing you could do something about it. And in this case, someone who got bumped sought revenge on the infectious stranger. And you probably would too.
Wow.
But is there anything we could do to alter this result and have people choose compassion, even for a jerk?
You're gonna go right to this first door on the left. Great, thanks so much.
Super.
You read it when she just started reciting Shakespeare?
Dude. This woman is having the same ugly run-in with our test subject. And she's got the same hot sauce choices. So will she choose death, too?
Fine. That's a lovely smile. Please, have a seat. Oh, you're welcome. Can I get you some water?
Sure.
Okay, cool.
Please proceed.
She chose the medium sauce, even though this guy ran her over just moments ago.
Any chance?
Right, thanks.
Yo, careful, man.
What about this guy? He'll want revenge, right?
Ben, nice to meet you. Please have a seat, sir. Can I get you some water?
Sure, please.
And how was your day, Ben, my man?
Good.
Mild sauce this time. What's going on here? Scientist was all business.
That is a one-way mirror. Subject cannot see.
Okay.
This time, he's friendlier to our volunteers.
That's a lovely smile.
And a little more, you guessed it, compassion.
Make yourself comfortable.
And time after time, our last group manages to find some compassion themselves and pick the mild or medium sauce, despite their run-in with the jerk.
Look at that!
This is because they were all shown compassion themselves by the scientists.
Can I get you some water?
Sure.
This is not just about giving hot sauce to a stranger. What this experiment reveals about compassion is that, like the common cold, compassion is actually contagious.
Yeah. So as you saw in the hot sauce experiment, you can actually prime others to behave more compassionately by behaving more compassionately yourself.
And when someone empathizes with you, you can then pay that compassion forward to the next person.
This is something to think about the next time you feel hostile or aggressive towards someone else.
A
simple act of kindness or compassion can produce the same feelings in others and cause a ripple effect that affects us all.
Just like our expert panel of babies, when you experience compassion, the chemical oxytocin is released in your brain, which stimulates more feelings of empathy. And the cycle continues.
But the truly amazing thing about being compassionate is that you can actually get better at it. The latest research shows that by engaging in compassionate behavior yourself, you actually strengthen your compassion reaction by creating new neural pathways in your brain. So whether you hold the door for a stranger or pay someone a compliment, when it comes to compassion, the more you give, the more you get. Did I mention, you look great today.
Truth is, people, what love do you have for yourself to get more love out? Because the love that you have for yourself is the good of you. You can give out everything that is you.
Pay attention.
Okay.
Well, you know that the love of you is the greater in you. For you, because once your heartbeat stops, you through. And your heartbeat got everything to do with you being really you. Everything else is bullshit. Think is the way you taught to think. And that part is life too. where you start to think. I'm just telling you, it's time to live up there and start thinking for yourself. The bullshit is you not telling the truth. You living a lie and lying to me. Brainstorm shit. I like this shit. This is made shit. Here's something to think about.
As he soars high above the ground, ask yourself one question. Would we be showing you this if something bad wasn't about to happen? The answer? No. And as you may suspect, this guy's ride is going to end painfully. In fact, he's about to crash into that tree down there. In 3, 2, 1. Now some of you might be cringing in anticipation, while others might be yelling at the screen, just show it to us already. Either way, we're guessing most of you at home still want to see what happens. It's really painful. Are you sure you want to see it? Okay, here it comes. Don't say we didn't warn you. But first, we have another question. Why would you want to see this so much? You know it ends painfully. Well, for one thing, it's not the pain you're addicted to. It's pleasure. Want to see more? Stick around. Think about your average day, starting with that first cup of coffee, then another when you get to work, then there's the phone calls, texts, emails, social media sites to post to, more coffee to get over the midday hump, another round of emails, texts, and phone calls. Then it's home to watch TV, surf the net, and check your email for the 100th time when you should be going to bed. Sound familiar?
We all have things we say we can't live without. Do you really want to be doing all those things? Or on some deep level, do you feel like you need to? When it comes to addiction, most people think of hard drugs or alcohol. Those are serious issues. We're here to talk about the thousands of smaller compulsions that make up our lives. Whether it's the next episode of your favorite TV show, a hot new game app, or an embarrassing pop song you find yourself humming, even though you don't even like it. And the reason why you become addicted to things has to do with the reward-seeking machine in your head, otherwise known as your brain.
And today, we're going to show you how, like it or not, we're all addicted to something. Prepare to get hooked. Brain games. Earlier, you watched part of this hang gliding video that we told you would end painfully. And it may have left some of you unsatisfied. So this time, we promise to show you the moment you've been waiting for. The crash. Don't worry, our hang glider wasn't seriously injured. But even though we told you how this was going to end, why did most of you want to see him crash anyway? Well, it's partly because your brain, especially your frontal lobe, which processes plot and narrative, loves a good story. When a new story unfolds, your brain tries to figure out what happens next, because your brain was designed to learn new things. Like, don't do this. It's one of the reasons you get hooked on movies and TV shows. Can't put down that novel or are dying to know the latest gossip.
It's weird.
As long as plot lines aren't resolved.
Get down!
Your brain keeps you coming back for more. Now, you might be thinking, sure, my brain can get hooked on a viral video like this one. Or this one. But I'm not really addicted to anything in my real life. Before you feel too confident, we want you to answer 3 questions and be honest. In the last 24 hours, have you had 3 or more cups of coffee, soda, or alcohol? Have you surfed the internet for more than 2 hours without getting up? Have you ever spent more than your budget allows while shopping online? If you answered yes to one or more of these questions, you're like 90% of the people we ask these to.
Which means, at the very least, you have a mildly addicted brain. Don't worry, we all share something in our brains that creates the potential for addiction. The question is, what is it? Find out. Let's play a game.
You've probably seen one of these before, right? But this is no ordinary slot machine. Because to win this game,
All you have to do is complete four simple analogies. Don't worry, they won't be as hard as the ones on the SATs. For each correct answer, you'll get a nice little reward. Get all four, and you win the game. Ready? Here's the first one. Stove is to kitchen as toilet is to what? If you said bathroom, good job. You're correct. Feeling good? Here's the next one. Desk is to furniture as triangle is to... Did you say shake? Way to go! That's also correct. How about this one? Carrot is to vegetable as green is to... I bet you said color. Once again, that's right. Wow, you're on a roll. See if you can go 4 for 4 and win the game. Candy is to sweet as pickle is to... Correct answer is sour. You win. So, how do you feel right now? Does it feel a little anticlimactic? After all, you just won the game. You were probably expecting something like this. Most of all, are you expecting a big payoff? You felt something was definitely missing. You're not alone. We quickly got your brain hooked on the rewards from this slot machine. So how did we do that? Everything about this game, just like an actual slot machine, is designed to get you hooked. The flashing lights, the ringing bells, even the progress bar. Here to explain why your brain gets hooked, biomedical engineer Dr. Sri Sarma.
Your brain quickly learns to link the sounds and flashing lights of the slot machine to a reward, the payout. Your brain then releases the neurotransmitter dopamine, which reinforces the link between stimulus and reward. The whole process is known as a reinforcement loop. The same kind of neurological pathway that gets triggered when you eat something delicious or engage in any pleasurable activity.
Because we trained your brain to expect a reward, you experienced a split second of neurochemical craving when we took it away, otherwise known as withdrawal. But wait, aren't withdrawal and addiction bad for you? Sometimes yes, but did you know that there's a positive side to addiction as well?
Your brain is designed to get you addicted to learning and exploring by releasing pleasure chemicals when you do anything new and exciting. Addiction only becomes unhealthy when this natural process spins out of control.
The question is, if our brains are predisposed to being addicted, how early in our development does this happen? Well, as we found out in this next experiment, pretty early.
Hi, guys! What do you do when you really want something, but your mom and dad say you can't have it? Can you first? Hey, it's a good answer. Yeah, with that smile for sure, yes?
Cry for it.
Cry for it. There you go. Get a little more dramatic. Is anybody else? What do you think?
You can go behind them and get it.
Yes, you can. Those are great answers. So now, who wants to play a game? You guys excited?
Yeah.
All right, let's play a game.
Looks like they're ready. First, we had to explain the rules.
All right. This is a delicious pink cotton candy.
Is it for real?
It's for real. I'm going to give you two choices, okay?
Mm-hmm.
You could choose to eat this now, or I'm going to leave for 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And if you can hold yourself and not eat it, I'm going to bring you two more. So then you'll have three.
Hold it, yeah, I'm going to take that choice.
This girl seems to know what's best for her taste buds. But can she really hold out the whole time?
I'll see you in 15 minutes, okay?
Okay.
All right.
We offered each of these 9 kids the same deal. If they didn't eat the cotton candy while left alone in the room with it, they'd be rewarded with even more of this sweet treat.
Greed. So
what they
Sean the kid, greed.
Is that we'd be watching the whole time with our cameras behind this one-way mirror. So here's the big question. Of the 9 kids taking part in this experiment, how many do you think have the willpower to hold out for the big payoff? And how many will give in to temptation? We gave these 9 kids a simple choice. They could have 1 piece of cotton candy now, or 3 pieces in 15 minutes.
provided they don't eat the first piece. But what they didn't know is that we'd be watching the whole time, and 15 minutes alone with that sweet treat might be too much to handle. So, how many kids will hold out, and how many will give in? I'll be back. Whoa, this kid barely waited until the door was closed before disqualifying herself. And so did this one. Luke, do you think the other 7 kids will give in just as quickly, or will they find a way to resist temptation?
Look at her. She's not even looking at it. Really? Out of sight is out of mind. The coping mechanisms are wonderful.
Wonderful. Boy, I'm loving you.
Kid.
Well, 50 minutes is a long time, especially for kids.
It's boring in here. Yeah. I want some juice. Can I take away to eat it without nobody knowing?
Sneaky plan. But we're watching. Now some of these kids are really struggling.
Oh, yummy.
What other strategies do you think they'll come up with to stay strong?
H-O-J-K.
Finishing the alphabet might do the trick. Or counting the time passing on your hands. And check out these two boys using teamwork to encourage each other not to give in.
Don't eat it. Yeah. I'm not going to eat it. I'm listening.
Maybe backing away completely is a good distraction. Or not. She's wheeling back in again. She's diving right in. Maybe she thought if she didn't touch it with her hands, it wouldn't count. But it does. And she wasn't the only one. Remember our two boys using teamwork to stay distracted? Looks like you're sorry, kid. You didn't win. But despite a few of them giving in, 5 of them managed to hold out for the full 15 minutes. You're good. Was that how many you thought would power through for the big payoff?
High five. Yeah.
So why is distraction more effective than simply trying to resist temptation? It's because resistance is a finite resource in your brain.
The usual strategy of fighting addiction using just willpower alone is a losing battle. The area of your brain that asserts willpower, the frontal cortex, only developed in the last 200,000 years.
Oh,
it's no match
it
for the most primitive parts of your brain.
That's why my little blue ass lighter. My boy. Yeah, I got another lighter in there, but I'm like, I left one just right there in my thing. No, I haven't probably got my blue lighter. Why is a lighter still in a little heifer, boy? I called her and she said, hey, appreciate you all working and everything. Oh, yeah, Miss Davis, I want to let you know I got your cup from your machine. I said, I know. That's a D. I don't lose my cup like you lose my bowl. I said, that's a part of that machine. She said, I know, Miss Davis, I'm going to give it to you today.
Take a look at this maze.
Oh, fuck.
We're
going to
give you
10 seconds. Hold it shit up. Fuck.
Pour
it into the goddamn other cup. Leave my shit.
I had to laugh at it because, you know, when he came here, it was like, okay, it got
to be in here.
When I told you that she had a smoothie, right then let you know that she had to be in take with her.
She don't bring shit back.
That's what I don't know.
I guarantee I bet she got 10 bowls. Classic bowls of mine. She never brought back. I said, look.
Sound anything like
that's a part of that machine. Bring that cup back now. Okay,
so bring the
that's
cup because
back.
The same
and she put the lid to it too. I'm talking about that. My
reason
why the cover set
around your brain right now.
I said, yeah, we love you. I got your message. We love you, D.
He
said, it's always
going to
be love, baby.
And like I said, yeah, like I told you, I said, D, I don't care what you do to me for me to stop loving you, for me to stop breathing here, because anything that you do, I know it ain't really you. It's just pressure on you that it got you fucked up. And she was like, I love you.
earworm is played, solving our maze. Working memory is activated and the earworm is stealthily implanted. So what makes these musical marvels especially catchy? Take another listen to our earworm from before.
Around her, nigga, you had to learn how to create fire.
And a back and forth beat. All of these features combine to create an irresistible earworm because your brain is attracted to the simple, repetitive melody and rhythm. The easier to hum along, the more your brain likes it. Now, some of you might be thinking, despite everything we've shown you about addiction, we couldn't possibly be talking about you. You didn't care what happened to this guy. You're not tempted by junk food, and you wouldn't be caught dead singing an awful top 40 pop song. But we're willing to bet there's something you are addicted to. In fact, you might be doing it right now. To find out what it is, take a look at our next experiment. We gathered 10 volunteers to take part in a simple focus group and asked them to fill out some standard survey forms before giving us their opinions about an upcoming TV show. Because this is a confidential focus group, we explained that if they wanted to get paid for their time, cell phone use while in this room was strictly prohibited.
You can bring up your cell phones.
So our volunteers placed their phones in these boxes, so they wouldn't even be tempted to use them during the focus group. Now it's time to begin.
Basically, what we're going to do is we're going to watch this video a couple times and just talk to you guys a little bit, okay?
I thought we had it going earlier.
Huh. Looks like they're having a problem with the video monitor.
Technical difficulty.
We're trying to set up the video.
Okay, just 1 second.
Please, no cell phones.
Seems like things aren't going according to plan. Or are they? These people think they're here to comment on TV shows. What they don't realize is they're part of an experiment on our show. We're watching every move behind a one-way mirror and testing to see if these participants can resist the urge to use their cell phones, which are conveniently placed just out of arm's reach. I know, we're back. As we saw earlier, our kid volunteers had trouble resisting a small piece of cotton candy. So how do you think these adults will handle cell phone withdrawal? Can they dial up enough willpower to hold out? Or will they call it quits? These volunteers think they're going to get paid for their opinions on some upcoming TV shows. What they didn't realize is that they'd be giving up their cell phones on our show, and we'd be watching every move behind a one-way mirror. If anyone breaks down and uses their phone, they won't get paid. Think they can resist the urge and play by the rules? And what about you? If you were in this room, how long could you go without checking your phone? Just think of all the emails, texts, and social media you'd be missing. But surely with money on the line, these folks will be able to demonstrate some degree of willpower to play by the rules, right? Wrong. After just 5 minutes, this guy couldn't resist taking a peek. After 10 minutes, most of our volunteers followed instructions and didn't check their phones. But we're about to turn up the heat. Remember that form they filled out earlier? Included was a space to fill in their cell phone number. So now we can call and text them. See? I told you we were bad.
It's very hard for me to sit still.
So will these people give in to temptation now that their phones are literally calling out to them? The answer? A resounding yes. As soon as their phones started ringing, beeping, and buzzing, a whopping 80% of our volunteers couldn't resist the call, leaving just 2 people who were able to remain in their seats.
Hello?
In fact, once the floodgates opened, some of these rule breakers not only took our calls,
I don't know who it is.
They started making their own.
Hello?
It's all or nothing on this one.
Just to look at
their phone.
I had to go and check it at some
point. As soon as I gave it up, I wanted it back in my pocket because I have to be in close contact.
Sitting there, having nothing else to do, that's when I want to check it. If I was doing something important, I would be fine. I think.
What's that? But not my phone.
Clearly, it's difficult for our brains to resist the call of our devices, and with good reason.
Psychologist Martin Lindstrom has surveyed the most addictive sounds in the world.
Meaning, sounds our brains crave because of the possible reward behind them.
And not surprisingly, sounds associated with cell phones are second only to those of giggling babies. You're probably saying, so what? Isn't my phone designed to get my attention? True. But how many times a day do you find yourself checking your phone no matter where you are or what you're doing? Since this episode began, how many times have you looked at your phone? Be honest. 3 times? 5? Maybe more?
So what's behind this burning desire to constantly look at our smartphones? It turns out, our brains have been trained over time to have an almost Pavlovian response to our phones. As our brains seek out dopamine rewards wherever they can find them.
These days, if you check your smartphone, your brain gets rewarded each time for learning something new, whether it's hearing from your friends or checking the weather.
And according to some research, your dopamine levels don't actually peak when you win a bet, get good news, or eat that simple treat. But rather, they spike in the moment just before the payoff. Which may be why we risk that. Each time when we anticipate how many messages or social media likes we may get, our brains focus on the right thing. In other words, the pursuit of happiness isn't really about happiness. It's about the pursuit. And if you're worried about our participants forfeiting their money, don't be. We paid them all anyway.
Yay!
So now that you've learned how to better manage your addicted brain, see if you can resist one final temptation with illusionist Max Darwin.
If you're like most people, you can't start your day without a morning cup of coffee. Would you say that's true? And of course, it's not the coffee that we're addicted to, it's the caffeine. Number one addiction in America. Oh yeah. The best way to kick the habit is if it's not available to you in the first place.
Hey, that's my...
Whoa, how did he do that?
What the?
Out of sight, out of mind.
And how's she going to get her morning fix?
Yeah, I should buy you a cup of coffee. Can I buy her a cup of coffee? Sorry about that.
Listen to this audio clip and see if you can tell what's being said. Ready? Here we go. Can you make out any words at all? Chances are, you have no idea, right? Let's hear it again. Can you understand it now? We'll help you out. Listen to the clip without any distortion.
This is a show about your brain and language.
Now, here's that first clip, the one you couldn't understand. Hear it now? Pretty crazy, huh? Nothing's different about the distorted clip. The only thing that changed is your brain. The human brain is a remarkable language machine, and it has to be. We use language to talk, read, write, and connect every day. And with over 7,000 languages worldwide, we'll never run out of things to say. So get ready to speak your mind on Brain Games.
There's great power in language. Language allows me to take a thought from my brain and implant it into yours, using nothing but words. But have you ever stopped to wonder, what is language, really? Why do words mean what they mean? As language evolves, what will it sound like in 10, 50, or 100 years? Exactly, my friend.
Let's go back to that clip we played you earlier. It sounds nothing like human speech. Before we explain what's going on, let's try another. Can you understand the message? Make your best guess. Before we reveal what it is. Got it? Here's the clear version.
A picture is worth 1,000 words.
Now listen to the distorted version again. Can you understand it now? So what's going on in your brain when these clips go from random sounds to language you can understand? Your brain has a special area designed to separate language from all the other sounds in the world. This language detector, known as Wernicke's area, is so powerful that once you hear the clear version, it adapts to match these raw sounds.
Are you getting better at hearing these?
To their meaning.
Are you getting better at hearing these?
Your brain's ability to detect sounds is the first step in understanding language.
But have you ever wondered, why do words mean what they mean? To answer that question, we're going to play a game.
Take a look at these two chocolate bars. Chocolate number one is a creamy milk chocolate. Chocolate number two is a bitter, dark chocolate. One of them is called Katiki, and the other is called Lumba. Think you know which is which? Don't overthink it. Just match each name to the chocolate bar it feels like it belongs to. Got it? We're betting you said Lumba is the milk chocolate, and Katiki is the dark chocolate. Can we guess your answer? And if you think we just got lucky by guessing exactly which name you would pair with which bar, let's try another one. Take a look at these two shapes. One of them is called Tagete. The other is called Maluma. Which one is which? Take a moment to decide. Got your answer? Let's hear what others have to say and see if you agree.
Which shape is Tagete and which shape is Maluma? Tagete is on the left and Maluma's on the right.
I'm gonna go with Tagete being the left one.
Tagete would be the object on the left. Maluma would be the object on the right.
Every single person said this is Tagete and this is Maluma. We're willing to bet you said the same thing. Don't you find it a little strange that everyone agrees? We'll let you in on a little secret. These words are completely made up. They're nonsense. These shapes could be called anything. The secret is in the language our participants use to describe both shapes. Listen carefully.
Tagete to me sounds more jagged, pointy-edged.
Jagged, crazy, stuff going on.
Kind of seems like an Asian throwing star.
How about Maluma?
Maluma just kind of rolls off the tongue like a mush.
Like a blobby, yummy boy thing, or like...
No.
Yeah.
This woman figured it out using the power of dance.
Maluma. Soft. Wiggle. Tagete. More like a robot.
Why is Tagete universally sharp and Maluma round and squishy? And why does Lumba make the most sense with creamy milk chocolate and Katiki go with bitter dark chocolate? Here to help translate with biomedical engineer Sri Sarma of Johns Hopkins University.
Our brain may instinctively link certain sensory information to specific sounds and language. It's called sound symbolism. How an object looks, smells, or even tastes can determine the sound of a word that describes it.
Your brain might link something that looks soft or things that taste creamy, like that milk chocolate, with soft-sounding language, while sharp consonants can evoke pointy shapes or bitter tastes. The fact that the vast majority of people share the same sound symbolism may be evidence of ancient universal sounds. For example, the sound mmm has a maternal connection in many languages. Mom, ma, ma, madre, madre, mujer, ama. You get the idea.
In fact, research has shown all babies are born with the ability to learn any language on Earth. If you take a 6-month-old and drop it anywhere in the world, it will learn the language. It's an instinct. Hardwired into your brain.
That's amazing.
It is amazing. But even more remarkable is that when it comes to learning any language, what's least important are the words. Don't believe it? Pay attention to these twins. You need to decide if they're actually communicating or just making noise. Ready? Here we go. The majority of people we showed this to agree they're communicating in some way. It may sound like just one word, but it's not your typical baby babble.
language isn't just words. Pitch, tone, and inflection all work together to create meaning. Scientists call it prosody. It's the rhythm that underlies all language. These twins are a perfect
example. Well done out there. The money's in
the natural pauses in their speech as their tone rises and falls musically.
These babies could be prosody experts precisely because they're twins. One study found that 40% of twins develop a unique code with one another long before learning their native language. And if you look carefully, they're using something else to communicate too. Body language. This is no accident. Your brain's ability to read body language can tell you a lot about someone without them saying a word. We're about to put it to the test. Imagine you've been called into this business meeting.
45% is definitely possible.
I agree as well too. I mean, the numbers show it.
Wait a minute. There's something wrong with these numbers. This is not working.
Before you can impress the boss, you need to figure out who it is. But there's a twist. We're taking away the tool you use most often to know who's who. Spoken language. In a minute, we're going to ask you to figure out who's the boss using nothing but body language. By the time you're done with this test, you'll know the secret body language moves you can use to rise straight to the top. Imagine you've been called into a business meeting and you don't know who anyone is.
It's a scene that plays itself out in offices across the world every day.
People tend to fall into certain types, and around this table are five of them. The ball of stress, the nervous Nelly, the aggressive one, the second in command, and the boss.
Your job is to figure out who's the head honcho, using nothing but body language.
And you're going to find the boss using process of elimination. Pay attention to each person around the table. See if you can figure out what their body language is telling you. Ready? Let's begin. Focus on the woman in purple. Now, the guy next to her. Next, what is the man in the red tie revealing? Now, look at this woman. Finally, check out the man in the yellow tie. Think you know who's who based on body language? Focus on this woman. Anytime someone speaks to her...
Interesting ideas, people. What's your favorite?
She hides her thumbs.
While not all experts agree on the meaning of body language cues, some believe that hiding your thumbs can be seen as a sign that you lack confidence or are fearful.
We know she's not the boss, but who do you think she is? If you said she's the nervous Nelly, you're right. Now take a look at the man in the red tie. Who do you think he is? He keeps fiddling with his pen. Touching his neck.
Good chance. Check out my sister on Facebook.
Touching the neck is thought to be a self-soothing gesture and a sign that someone is in distress.
That look says, please don't fire me. He's this office's ball of stress. Question is, which of these three remaining people
is supposed to
be the command? Ziploc. Ziploc. And had a mouth Ziploc.
Is the boss this guy?
Wait a minute. There's something wrong with
shot in the foot and slit her with a box of razor.
Let's think about this together in a rational way.
To right
see
here,
keeping the peace.
They gave a close up as she was talking. I said to you, nurse.
I just don't know
way.
Got your answer?
What's on title?
Special cargo.
See if you're right.
Fork.
Look at this guy. I disagree.
See
how much space he's taking up his body.
He's willing to encroach on others' personal space, a sign he wants to be the alpha male. But aggression doesn't mean leadership.
Not making sense here. Apparently, story is, I think, she was going to divorce him, and that's what happened. And you see her, and she's a... And the voice can be fucked up when you got young kids. So... And you know, she looks like... She's... He 50. She... He looks like... He's 20 years older than her. I sent to you. We can tell by him.
20 years?
He looks like he got about 20 years. Like, look at him. And look at her. She's got four kids. He's 50. She's about 30-something. She's 30-something. You see the picture. She looks much younger than him. With four young kids. Older dude. With a fucking younger woman.
He feeling like she really believes in him.
Well, you know, figure, okay, let's just say them kids were... The age range, I got to look more at the store. I don't know the age range, but they were young kids. They were children. They called them kids. First four kids. Like from, I don't know if they're from high school age, elementary school age, whatever the age is. They killed all four of them. I'm like, you had to be young kids for this to kill four kids. Like, you know, big kids be hard to kill them. You know?
Big kids, they got the group, they're the group on that.
You know, big kids, look here.
They ain't understanding what happened.
Yeah.
Because any other kid that had our dad didn't run.
They wanted them to light them up, bro, but they gave him 60 to 97 concurrent, some other stuff. But they said by chance he would be time for parole, he'd be 97. And the court said, we hope you never get to that age. Right. And you should hit yourself, it's gonna fuck you up because... You know, see, he's saying yeah, but he's doing the DOD thing. He's saying yeah, but he's saying, God still got a plan for him. And in the court, the girl came and says, the depth of how he's hurt my family. He said, my mama, she can't hardly get out of bed, knowing her four grandkids she just loves so much of gone. Said she having a hard time. Said, but the person taking heart is my dad. He's so messed up now. You know, he's not saying he felt after something like that happened, you feel helped that you couldn't do. Now I know how he felt as a dad. Do fuck my girl up and one shit I could do and my grandbabies. Well, and there wasn't shit I could do. See, for me, I have to go deep on. I would have checked him from the fucking beginning when they ever got to that point. I promise you. So look, that dude right there, let me tell you something. A real light-skinned dude, real light-skinned fella, you understand? And there's a white part in him that's real fucked up. Even my brother, you know, dark male, like nigga, crazy motherfucker too, but this dude, man, he sat through that motherfucking man motionless, like, you know, man, you sitting there and you getting your sentence. Man, if I had, that would happen, but I'm just saying, the emotion of just knowing, I could never do that. I can't even do what he did, even if it wasn't my kids, because I'm assuming, a couple of them kids weren't his.
That's a hard thing to do, man.
You know they weren't his biologicals. So I think that's some nigga she's married to that had. She has some kids already. Maybe one, cause
he did that to hurt her, dog. He does look like I said.
Cause she was divorcing him, man.
That wasn't his kid. He did that to hurt her.
Well, that's dangerous. But divorce is dangerous.
Yeah, it is dangerous. You said that a while back. They say one thing about divorce is dangerous, boy. Because two people, when one say it's over, the other
feel
like
it. Let me tell you what a danger is. When a nigga finally see you. See, if a nigga ain't seen you yet, ain't no danger. See, I live with the moment that I see Roscoe.
Yeah.
Do you understand me?
Because like I said again,
I ain't seen him yet.
Everything changes.
Everything changes.
Because, see this, but and see this on my show too, and I mean it from my heart. I'm telling the truth. When a person see a person naturally happy in their heart, it do.
Because he gonna see something different by Lane with me. He's gonna fuck with that nigga. So, because the nigga ain't got over it yet. You know that he ain't nowhere near. He ain't nowhere near it because his daughter feels it, and she shared it with the middle boy. Because they gonna have a talk with mom this weekend. And DJ, the oldest, know what all the bullshit about is. Because, you know, they in my business. They right, in my business. And then I told her, I said, what you do? You let that. I said, you control the shit. I said, you tell them, y'all going to speak, and then I'm going to finish. And when we finish, we're going to have a nice lunch. I'm going on with my business. And that's all it is.
Oh,
she already told me, because I said, you fully grown.
Yep.
And said, I don't know if I have to go through the bullshit you going through.
Because the whole thing is this here, dog. And
divorce him is hard.
But you get the whole thing is this here, dog. You got to understand the old stand, understand the siblings.
Oh, that, man, I know him.
Dad heartbroke right now.
Huh?
He heartbroke.
Well, he's heartbroken, and Garvey don't know what to do.
It ain't worth shit right now. Unreal. This nigga, I wish that I could see this nigga and I could go right roll up into him and talk.
Well, see, the daughter's feeling that.
Right, that's what.
And you know what she's feeling? I said that day, she was sitting there just staring at me at the place.
And you know why she was staring
at me? You got my mama so happy because you're fucking the shit out of her. You got her sprung. You got my mama sprung like she wanted to be sprung years and years ago. That's what y'all don't realize. She got with the person she always wanted to be with.
And I'm with
she went through two bullshit marriages to get to me. That's the whole bottom line. And I went through two.
Like I said again, the daughter can't do nothing. Because the daughter looking for the same happiness too.
That's what the daughter looking for too.
Is this what it is?
This is a comeback too. This ain't
no bullshit.
Yeah.
No bullshit. And seeing, and the daughter ain't getting it like that. The son got it, because the son already.
Oh, the baby, the oldest got the baby, the middle boy's one don't have it.
Yeah.
But the oldest and me, we bonded so young. I bonded with him a long time ago.
See, because the youngest one know the truth is, he know what he's trying to do. That one there. The one that got his son, you're talking about, right?
Huh?
The one that have his son, trying to get his son back or something.
Yeah, the one got his son.
He know the truth when he feel it, and he know the truth.
Well, hell, because he went through a divorce with a girl.
Like I said again.
And a skeezer.
See, like I said again.
I'm talking about a nice looking woman
around
who have four other kids and got two. She got eight kids.
And have you around there to help balance that boy out with his age and the shit he's going through. So like I said again.
A real nigga talking to him.
Yeah,
not like Roscoe.
Yeah.
Roscoe been a good feeling dad. I said, you know, because well, he on point, take care of shit, understanding, gay balance. But where there was no balance, they always, let me tell you something, them kids always knows how mom treated them.
They noticed
that.
His choices, see? He got the choices of Roscoe when he chose this little rinky-dink-ass bitch that he chose to have the babies with.
Yeah.
That was the chosen of the being around him, settling for her, even though she ain't love him. You think I'm saying? So that was the reason why he ain't with that skeezer bitch skeezer, because he's a good dude. He's a good dude because of the mama side of that situation.
Oh, yeah.
You dig?
Because when dude, let me tell you something. If she and I been together, and that situation come, because I knew that little boy. We hung out when he's five. We bonded real young, you know. And I said, if I had married you, you'd never married me.
No, it wouldn't have married. I'm trying to tell you, Roscoe was the reason why he settled with that risky bitch that he did to marry. I mean, having a baby with.
And then, guess what?
Oh, in the marriage, yeah.
Let's think about this. And now the middle boy, who is married to a white girl, and she's real. She's one of them. She's a control. She's a control domineering girl. And see, Nikki don't like the way she doesn't give them access to the grandkids.
Oh, yeah, what's not like that?
Cause she say, and then is, but you know, drawn kind of happy wife, happy life.
Right, that's why you don't do no drama. But I'm saying that any grandmother,
but guess what, though? He might have married that white girl, he might not have married that white girl if I had been their dad.
No, he wouldn't have. I'm trying to tell you, he wouldn't have. If you tell you what, Roscoe fucked up everybody when Roscoe settled for something that didn't really want him. And
he made all that shit dysfunctional.
All that dysfunctional, man.
Seriously?
He made all that dysfunctional.
Now, this is the truth.
Because
you gotta remember them two boys had a daddy who wasn't really instrumental in their life. So Roscoe was more instrumental.
And let me tell you the other part of the truth, the other creator always telling me to tell you too. His heart wasn't in because she wasn't into his heart. Like he was into hers. And he wasn't doing all that he could do for them boys.
And here's the thing with
how
Lane,
he was feeling.
And what Lane told me, she said he was just a user.
Mm-hmm.
He find women that have potential making money and he just used to say, use me. He said,
one thing about her though, the difference between her and all the rest of them.
I'm ready to go on this.
He loved the ground that she walked on. Her is totally different than all the rest of who he just fucked.
I'm talking about the first dude. She said he was a user of women. He used
womanizer
for what I could get. There was no love, and you know, she said I could have loved him, but he was just physical.
That's it. He was on how she looked.
But I said, you know what? It's sad that it had to be that way with him. I said, because in the real, if I got with you before you, because I was real, if we got married, I said, boy, everything would have been so different.
Let me give you the flip flop on all that what would have changed, because I'm getting it clear. If we get in here breathing together, it would have changed. She'd have everything that she had, but everything would be stable. The dude wouldn't be who he is.
Let me tell you something.
Because you would have stayed with it out.
Let me tell you what you learn about a woman. Now, I look at a relationship. He knows she fucks with me, right?
I'm here for you. I'm here for
you. 100%. Sometimes, the creator knew that early on, it wouldn't be right for her and I.
I'm about to tell you that too.
I'm saying it wouldn't be right for her and I because. Our personality, our personalities like each other so much. But they were almost like the same personalities, you know. Go-getters, you know, move fast. She gonna speak her mind. I'm gonna speak my mind.
Cause since we know who the creator is in us, it's like as if y'all, both of y'all hearts knew that y'all had to grow more to end up being able to come together like y'all are right now. Cause then everybody wide open.
What Elaine admits to, she said, and then she said, I was just rebellious. She said, I'm living alone.
Yes.
And life's all right, you know. And said, but yeah, it was a way. It's like I can get out, cause my parents, you know, traditional parents, man, you know.
Hubbard.
You know, so I mean, if you're gonna be living in our house,
ain't that nothing gonna happen like that.
You can't be coming to me. That's not how they operate. And she said, I was like, I'm grown. I'm making my own money. I'm gonna go on and get with this nigga.
know, she did too. But guess what?
I told her, I said, you know what? I said, it never dawned on you to strike out on your own for a season. She said, no. I said, you know what? I said, and I said, really and truly, I said, this is your season. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I said, you're on your own. I said, but I'm here. I'm with you. And that's why I come up here and I help you and everything. I'm blending myself into the situation slowly. But she don't like being by herself. She never had to be.
Let me tell you something.
Yeah?
She's a woman. She ain't supposed to be.
Hmm?
She said she's a woman. She ain't supposed to be by herself.
Hmm. She never wanted to be like that.
Mm-hmm. And I'm, like I said again, with that boy that hindered everything. But like I said again, the creativity in y'all to create something special together, your hearts wasn't ready to come together just yet like that because you had time to
grow. No, that'd be the right season, yeah, man. And then, like I said, like, I was married too.
The whole thing would be like this. Y'all would have got together on wrong, righteous, unrighteous situation, and how could it be right of a situation when y'all both was in wrong?
You couldn't shake the boat. Mm-mm. The boat, 08 was cool, but any time before 08 would have been bad.
Yep.
It just would have been bad, bro. It would have been terrible, man. And then, like I said, the kids were younger then, they'd be more fucked up.
Right.
At least now, they grown. And so, let's have a talk with mom. We all grown and shit. Mm-hmm. I said, let me tell you something. My two daughters will never demand that out of me. And you know, I said, because that's just not how we roll. But I said, because you got a boy, you got two boys and a girl. Yeah. And I said, but your baby, your oldest boy was like, he was like, why y'all doing this?
He got nothing to do with that.
Well, he said, I'll be the mom because I'm moderating.
See, they, look, like I said again.
And as a moderator.
When I say he got nothing to do with it.
But he's like I said, always got my back.
Now, why I did? Because when I say he got nothing to do with it, he is going to be there just to moderate, yeah, nigga. It.
No telling what y'all niggas could have been.
Come on.
Like, I've been around you too.
Thank you.
I'm just saying.
And he know that. I'm trying to tell you what I'm feeling from not even meeting this dude yet. But just from you just explaining to me who he is and you talking
man,
to him.
Man, you know, when you get with someone, like then when you're young, been different, man,
because
I mean, I had a chance at 87, man.
Like I said, Dave.
87, I had my chance, man. I got Sandra pregnant, and she got married we graduated the same time from college, and she was a new nigga. I had a baby. Fuck.
and I went.
Fuck my shit up.
Look at this. And all went exactly how it was planned because.
Oh man, I can't go no way after yo.
Because you did.
Once life is conceived, yeah, everything,
yeah,
changed.
Yeah. you took it right out of my mouth. Because once y'all created that life form, partner.
Everything changed. Man.
Everything
you can't
changed.
Your life changed. You got a whole new life. You can't, it's crazy. That's why for a man to take four kids' lives like that.
But we'll go back, that man
destroyed journeys.
We'll go back to what we said is killing the world. Mental illness.
Oh yeah, they gotta be ill, man. That's mental gotta illness. Be all illnesses. Mental I mean, illness. it's a deep illness, man. And I mean, it's a mental fucking illness, and it's also illness in violence in the land. There's a spirit of violence. It's a violent culture, and it's perpetrated every day on this screen.
Yep.
Violence, mass violence, regular TV, mainstream, underground, violence.
And what?
Every aspect of this, and
then
violence.
And then I got to put on it with that violence, and then the gay agenda put on top of it. Just
then you got motherfuckers. I mean, I said no once that. Law and order. God damn. some shit motherfuckers do, and then you put it out in the airwave for motherfuckers to see. You got these shows that show what's the motherfucker, criminal minds. Just throw all them ideas of how to kill a motherfucker out there, man. You start seeing the strip lock and shit, man. Now, watch this. That's all that TV shit.
Now, watch this here. I'm gonna let you see the creative.
You didn't see the high rise in criminal activity 30, 40, 50, 60 years ago on television. You didn't see it. But guess what? The violence for that time was showed. It has escalated every year. When TV came into being, it was showing murder. It always had. You go back all the way back, James Cagney, Humphrey Bogart, I'm on top of the world, You've been seeing that shit forever.
Now I'm gonna show you the creator in you for what you just said to show the truth is you, period. Dog, you damn near said, with all that there is, the violence that there is, it just not really being really created. Because it's being created on the television to tell the lies to their vision to make it seem like it's all right.
Let me tell you something, man. I'll keep on running real. Every one of Lane's kids got guns.
Wow.
All of them got guns. All of them shoot at the range. All of them shoot.
Now, let me tell you something about what I just learned today. Compassion. Compassion is not having a tool to take life.
Hey, man. You know, these kids been living useless all their life. You know, this is a crazy ass city. And it's true.
And the compassion is slammed in.
Yeah. Why I say the compassion? They never shot anybody.
I know, but when I say that the compassion is slammed, just by what they're doing with their daddy because of how he's feeling, they ain't feeling how mama feeling. So why is he trying to confuse mama on her feelings when her feelings are straight?
What has happened? Let me tell you what's happened. They had a nice family gathering, and I was there.
Yep.
And
yep.
Now these motherfuckers,
yep.
Yep. Oh, this thing is real.
Uh-huh.
Oh, that was real. And look, let me tell you, they both like me, and they both have, you know.
The daddy's confused.
And so, they're like,
yep.
Mom,
yep.
What's up with you and Dave? Because he loves you. He's a real nigga.
Yeah, but that's
oh, real. But they know. Oh, let me tell you something. They know. Nikki told her dad, move on.
All right, but hey, get what then?
Told him and said, you gotta move on because mama. Yeah, she's ain't so, she wouldn't say mom with David.
All right, so now
she ain't never told her daddy, and she know who. She said, "Mama, I never told daddy
that
who you were David. I've never mentioned it." I said, "You sure about that?" I said, "You sure?" You know, she don't want to hurt his feelings.
Cause I said, now that I know that, you did. What the fuck is the meeting for?
And man, you know what I said? I said, embrace the meeting because it's good, man. We come together. Anytime you can get all your children together
in one spot, yo.
That is
a good day.
Awesome. Good day. I said, let me tell you something. You can keep it real with them.
Keep it real with them, bro.
Ain't nobody else. But here's what's fucked up. It was Sarah was supposed to come in the mix and. Nikki, like, it's fucked up because I don't speak my mind about how the grandkids
ain't getting my plate.
No,
ain't getting my act right.
They withdrawn. They with their daddy. It's two boys with their dad. It's all right.
It is.
It's all right.
They learn the man.
They with their daddy. Y'all know you girls won't call them up and say, "Can I come by and see him?"
Yep.
And Lane knows she can do that. And Lane say hello. She said, it ain't big on her agenda. Oh, she with her nigga. So it ain't all that shit ain't big on her agenda.
All right, I'm gonna say it like this. And when you get a chance to talk to you, Lane, tell exactly what I said too. That's something that she don't really have to worry about right now because that dude is trying to mold them into being men and he don't want them around some women.
Oh, that's absolutely right. I was like, you know, I think what here's what she's talking about is the strictness of, see, they know when Luke and Logan, they biracial kid, but technically his kids are biracial too, because her grandmother's white. She's a Creole girl. You're black, white, so they both biracial. But his two, like, they have fun because they have fun with daddy. But when that mom around, she kind of, you know, he don't get loose. He right. Like when that mom ain't around, right. He get loose, yeah. With his brothers. Because, yeah. You know, get that white girl. I said, you got to understand, that's a white girl. You know, he ain't gonna get loose. And this white girl teaches elementary school in Spring Branch, which is highly Hispanic and black. So she deal with that every day.
Right, yeah.
She's like, you gonna be cool. Mm-hmm. They like black, they both like
so,
black boys.
So she not do these weights, because at she gets to a certain age, they come by on their own.
Well, yeah, it's man, time. It's
that's all it is. Because, and I say it like yourself. And when
dad,
you think about it,
all I said, yep. I was around that dad.
And when I say this shit, because I mean it, because it comes from my heart. Why they with his, with their dad, duh? You dig?
That's the
man. Grandma, you already with your man.
Yeah.
So therefore, everything gonna go as planned.
But you know, man, like I said, man, it's good for the whole
coming
together.
Yeah, all the time.
Hey, really, that's the real, man. Okay, your time to set it all in.
Mm-hmm.
When y'all have finished with this, it be nothing else said. No. I said, I've been telling them, when you guys do your thing on the 11th, after that day, you see nothing else said. About what's going on in mama life. Mama okay. Mama got this. Mama got this. She told me, mama does have this. Oh yeah. I said, look, I said, we got this.
I'm telling you, like, and I was thinking, like, you see, when you was moving some shit around in there. I said, hey, she gonna demand that move, nigga. I'm letting you know that now.
Oh no, she's good, man. Cause she understands space and everything. We talk about that, man.
Okay, you know? So you cool still with the space shit?
Hmm.
You cool with the space shit? Cause me, I'm like, it's just me. I guess you right. Cause that you, I don't have no woman. That's why I feel like I feel. I'd have been left this spot. I'm sorry. I'm like, yeah, my dog, I love you. I'm gonna make sure I come by here like I do now living here. But I got
that's why, you know, you do things in the, you know,
I did, because you're a different sex than me. See, you're a real deep and ordered nigga, dog. You're a real deep. Me, I would have left the surrounding. Why I would have left the surrounding? Because I'm happy with her. I know where I want to be.
Oh, yeah, I'm very happy, man.
You
dig?
I know where I want to be at.
And I love Snowflake. I got
an aching feeling in my heart, because it's like, this is something that got to happen, because
what I'm also aware of is, I don't like them niggas.
Marinate some shit, yeah.
Man, I ain't on your mama because of what she got.
Oh, Dad, let me tell you something about that, Dad. Let me tell you something about that.
And that's the number one thing. I got places to go. I always want them young folks to know, I got places to go, too. I ain't going to be living up on your mama like that. That ain't my whole aim. You understand?
Let me tell you something. But I ain't meet none of these people yet, but the order from you being around these people is what I get from the daughters and everybody. See the daughter? The daughter already knows that you have more power in you from wherever you live at. That don't even much matter. It's you being in presence of people that sparks their intuition. Because when you was in the room with her, all she could do was go, damn, mom got it.
Yeah. And her roommate, man, Abby, was for the A. She got mama gorgeous too. Abby's mom is
gorgeous. And we gain weight. We trying to get her on our eyes off, you know? She trying to, she, her mama doing some other kind of, never, we gonna get her, but Aiden's sitting right here at the table.
Hold on, yeah. So you say the mom is gorgeous?
Yeah, Aiden's mother is gorgeous. But her dad, they going through, I mean, they going to see this whole thing.
Her roommate and her best friend, mom and dad, who've been together forever, divorced. So it's like, it ain't nothing new what's going on. Her best friends. And you talking about all of them is tight. Everybody know each other very well. Because these girls have been college, they've been best friends, college roommates. Now they're roommates in real life. They like sisters.
You got to realize, bro, a lot of people selling with their situation because they're
believing. Oh, man.
That's that Jesus shit. And they knew one thing.
Well, you know what, man?
When I say that, it's
about attraction.
Right, but no, but I'm saying, but most of them stay because they say that, well, this is what Jesus would want me to do and all this other. That's what makes a whole bunch of people stay together.
I mean, just like me and Sandra and we doing them kids get right, we can get right. We don't want to fuck our kids up.
Don't want to fuck the kids
up. That's right. That. Everybody does that. That's why his mom and dad, they hung together. His mom and dad were together while they were in college. This shit, you know, they said within the last 8 years, Ebony's mom and dad, but they've been together all that time while she's in school, doing shit, getting shit done. And then when the kid get grown, let me tell you something, you hear more stories like that than ever. When the kid get grown, ain't nothing spiritual in that. Nothing that is spiritual. Mm-hmm. No, life is spiritual. But, hey, you want to make sure the people that you're raising be able to handle what's going to get ready to take place. Because she taught her dad every day and taught her mom every day. You know, while we were sitting there, her dad called. I met her daddy. We said, PB, he's a PB grad. Met at homecoming when we went to homecoming this past year. Had a nice talk with him, man. Nice dude, man. You know, he was a baseball player for TV and everything. Good conversation with him, and that's Ebony's daddy. I said, oh, I seen her talking to Ebony. I said, I know your daddy. Had a nice conversation. Good guy, man. Hey, good things, you know. Mm-hmm. You ain't the one. Folks ain't hanging around like that all the time no more. If they find the one later on in life, they're going to it.
Yeah, because you got to sit there and think about it, dog. Happiness only comes one time, it comes around again for you, and you get that one time, and then it comes around again for you. Shit, you can't do nothing but grab it the second time because you didn't grab it the first.
And with kids, and it's like in this situation, you know. They see mama in a light they never seen happy, loving, bouncing, sitting next to a nigga, but not all over niggas, but just letting them know.
I say like this, D. Let them know that I love this nigga.
Yeah.
If they fuck that light shit, because
you know, I'm just saying,
I got to use the speech, but yeah, I'm letting them know I like this
they
nigga.
Know.
You did, because
they know. What they can't process is 1979 to 2017. That, you know, they was born in we got the 90s. And that's the one that really get it. The 80s.
Yeah,
the first one.
Yeah.
The 80s. 82. He's an 82 baby. That's 80s. Yeah, he get it. The one that's born 5 years later, Jerron, 80 baby, 87. He get it, but he really won't understand it. This is because he is an accountant, and he got an accounting mind.
Yeah,
he just wants to.
You got D mind.
He wants just, okay, so mom, this dude.
What's going on?
Da-da-da-da-da. He want to know, you know.
What is his
aspect.
Stability? What is his stability?
And that's it.
I know you do.
And that's it.
Because he an accountant, nigga.
He's all about what he got. He's trying to live up on your mama. And I just thought about that. Not just that, and her too, because she got a gun.
Anytime you got that peacemaker, you gotta have the mindset of why you want to keep peace with that man.
So heavy.
You see what I'm saying? Goodness. You dig? You gotta have the mindset on why you want to have peace with that peacemaker. Now, see her? She might believe in motherfuckers that like to get over. And she could pretend.
Oh, man, she,
like,
but you know, that first relationship fucked her up. Right. Her dad.
Yeah.
Your dad fucked your mama up. Yeah. I want you to understand who fucked her mind up.
Yeah,
from a relationship standpoint, he fucked her mind. Because your physical, going, man, she's a little woman, man. Man,
he fucked her up and a little younger.
We older now. Yep. You know, look at it and say, you hit on this one, huh, nigga? Yep. I'm like, you know, but let me say this, though. She swung on him. And she threw things. When she picked up, you know.
Anger issues.
She still called her mama and said, I'm gonna kill her, mama. Mama, Lane, don't do that. Just get out of the house, mama. You hurt me bad. I'm gonna kill her.
And see, guess what, dude? And that's another thing, too. I'm saying from my heart, too. That's why she went into horse, dealing with horse, bro. Because she was gonna really kill that dude.
She hurt me, but hit me bad.
Do you hear me, Dave?
Yeah, man. Not only physically, mm-hmm. but he brought an STD home to her.
Ooh, man.
Another woman.
That, like I said again, that did more than anything else.
She might want to kill him after that.
Kill is on the mindset.
Ain't gonna come on like that. Gonna give her some shit. She's gonna die. It's like,
come on, dog.
Dave, you got sexually transmitted disease.
Dave, you got something somebody else gave to somebody that's supposed to be just with you. Fucking right, you going to kill that some bitch. Because that bitch wasn't enough, smart enough to protect
herself. But in this situation was a physical. She forgave him. You know. I said, wow. So, got two kids. Fuck. And then she said, the house we got, I bought. I left it. I told my dad I'll never go back in that house. I left. I'll probably fuck my credit up, Dave. You know, all I did for that man, I was physically abused, and then he brought home a sexually transmitted disease to me.
Wow. Man, she wanted to kill him, dog, because I'm just trying to tell you, bro.
An STD, dog, from another woman.
All you could think about, dude, is...
Oh, you fucking unfaithful.
Unfaithful, not just
that's why she married fucking Roscoe, because he was, what's the word? What's the word for Roscoe? I had it.
Loyal.
No. Word that means that he won't hurt me. He was safe.
Okay, yeah, safe, all right.
I married Roscoe. He was a safe one, man. He was gonna do that because she helped him become what he was, though. Uh-huh. So she gonna help him. She gonna help whatever nigga she get with. Okay. That's just in her spirit. Uh-huh. She gonna do that. Okay. She can, you know, she has the ability to do that. So, Roscoe was safe. And then she knew she had him. She could wrap him around her thumb, cause she got a boss bitch attitude. Exactly. She got a boss bitch attitude.
Yeah, man. Boss bitch.
I always fuck with her about that. Yeah, you got a boss bitch attitude, but I ain't a boss bitch nigga. So I said, understand that. I said, look. I said, I ain't hustling for corporate America no goddamn more. I ain't out there trying to bust my ass and make you know, unlimited income. I said, shit, kill myself. I want to hang out with you and do some things and work when I want to work and make money when we want to make money.
Enjoy life, shit.
But I want to have some fun.
Enjoy life, man, shit.
And so she's like, hey, I understand that for real. And we having fun. My kids, if they only knew how long she and I have really put off what she said. She said,
That ain't why I feel no truth. If I seen you, and if I seen you in the last 5 6 years, we'd have been mad. It'd been messed up. So we'd been having sex and doing stuff we ain't supposed to do, and been messed up for everybody. So that's why I ain't bother you. I stayed on the phone. I never tried to go. I was working up in the Woodlands. I was close. Working in the Woodlands, nigga. And I know how close I am now, because I was working real close to you.
Hey,
I said, Lane, well, I was at the Woodlands, I was about 15, 20 minutes from you, and we could.
Now you tell me. That was all the power that you had against the creator of your heart to not go anywhere you wanted to go in with her, but you knew that it was the right thing to do.
I'm gonna tell you what the common motherfucking sense nigga. Look, that she married, I'm unmarried. That's a poster for disaster anyway. Cause I'm free to fuck shit out of her. She paid for the hotel. I know she would. She paid. Oh, you want to see? And all it took. Cause the first time I saw her, 16, she still married and everything, and we just ate dinner, and she ready to, you know, it's the physical attraction, man. It's the feeling that you have for somebody you're supposed to be with.
Yep.
That's all it is, man. It's somebody the woman that was supposed to.
Magnetic.
And so you can't, the gravitational pull there, brother. It is what it is, man. So that's what we didn't. And I knew if I saw her, knew if we got somewhere, together, it's going to be on and popping.
Nigga, all y'all had to do was just start talking face to face.
It was the timing, was perfect. And it was like, they think, because Nikki thinks we probably been together like a couple months, 3 months or something. Nikki don't know. I was dating your mama for a whole year, and your mama's kind of condensed things into like the last 90 days. And we've been messing around a whole year, bro. We've been to Atlanta. We've been to February. We've been around, man. One knows this is DJ.
And I think, she don't have to tell him that then. DJ gonna tell that.
Oh, it's gonna be DJ, every confidential thing, DJ, I'm going da 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 da. Okay, mama.
She ain't nobody, she just met. He just haven't been having sex.
I said, man, how about your mama? We never said we hated each other. No time in life. We just parted with separate ways. And every time we hook back up, that chemistry. So when I said, I got back
to mother,
and you were 5, and your brother was 2. I said, man, I said, your brother wasn't even 2. I think your brother was born 86. I was 87. Your brother was probably like a year and a half. He was still in the arm. And I said, man, I was supposed to marry her then. I just didn't think I had the means to do it. It made more logical sense to marry Sandra because I could take care of my kid. It was like a decision.
Mm-hmm.
My dad said, yeah. He said he's ready to take care of another man's crumb snatches.
Mm-hmm.
And your child is.
We
talked about this. I made a decision to marry Sandra. After 87, I was supposed to marry Elaine. 88, I married Sandra. 89, she married Roscoe.
Ain't that so? Somebody always says one thing about
a 3-year period, brother.
87, 88,
89 changed all our lives. And our lives were already changed anyway because, we had kids. She had to do something that was safe because she had 2 boys. You can't take 2 other kids into a relationship with a man that's not safe. Okay. That could be a pedophile. What the fuck? You don't want, you know what I mean? You don't know what kind of ways a Negro have. You know, those boys. Or an abuser. She didn't want to get with another abusive relationship because she had been abused by their dad.
She was already hurt by a nigga, dog. She had to go to safety.
So I think a lot of this is in it's unusual now. Women, both his sons are gravitated to are lighter complexion women, light skin, Creole, white girl. One man, white girl, he told me he took a white girl to the prom and shit, DJ. So he messed with white girls and he got the next best thing when he married Creole. White and black, a mix.
Wow, I don't know how to get that.
Hey man, and you know, this girl, she put that snapper on him. And she's good looking, man. She's been, you know, she's tight, right? You know, you look at the old picture, she look like something you want to hit. Yeah, he's a young dude, you know. Damn. Not young, but young. She looked like, but she has sick kids already. I said, Elaine, she told me, when he got married, you know, this was like 09, something like that. 09, maybe 10, somewhere in there. 10, 11. I was telling her, man, I'm going to say 09. Tell Elaine, I said, so she got six kids? I'm like, I said, how many babies did I? She said, one guy she got four kids from and no ring. And then she got another guy with two and the DJ. So three daddies, eight kids. DJ got two, four from one dude, two from another. You got it?
Damn.
The first dude gave her four, no ring. The second dude, two.
No ring.
No ring.
And the third dude, two, and a ring.
Now see, then DJ.
That's what I just said. Good dude.
Put a ring on it.
The good dude.
They got child support from all three of them.
I'm just being honest with what I get out of the whole situation to how I feel.
I said, Elaine.
DJ, good dude.
I said, your son. He's special.
He's special dude.
I said, and his credit, he bought a house. He got a house. She living in the house. And some other niggas been up in there putting dick in. Hey, so now he looking at me. I mean, looking at his mom, but the connection he and I had, because, you know, when he first got his divorce and stuff was going on, and I challenged one night, she put on my phone and said, hey, man, I was going, man. Good, man. Is everything good? Yeah, I said, well, I haven't seen you since you was about five. I said, but I know a lot about you. So we get a chance to talk. And I said, good. I said, well, man, you take care.
That's a good dude, though.
Good dude, man.
It's
good.
A certain type of nigga that didn't take on four niggas.
Took on six of them, man. Plus, and he had two. So, it was a time she said, Dave, there was time she would go out. He'd be up there with
him. Oh, and his two.
At one point, he said, yeah, two. Four, somewhere in and out, because and then they've got what happened, the breaking point. Then the whole thing was, you know, she worked with Harris County. She carried a gun on him, and something else happened. And, you know, she and I had talked about that, you know, and they tried to jump him. Some couple of kids, her and her sister. And she told him, come on, DJ. So you come to the house. You know, yeah, that's what jumped off. That's where everything, you know, it was getting getting bad at that point, mm-hmm. and so, you know, but they got the divorce, man, and you know, he has custody, he gets to see kids, you know, and got his own place. That's when we had this little housewarming, apartment warming party, man.
Oh,
and,
that's a good dude.
So, you know, he's on the comeback, man.
Yeah, you don't got
he's on the comeback, and his boys set their room up and everything, man, all the stuff. I love him, man. I helped him move up in there, get all the stuff, man. And the middle son, we all had a chance to kick it. And they gave me that shot of Dragon Sauce. This is shit, man. And I told Lane, I said, you know what? I said, even though I was nice, it didn't faze me as far as, I said, my dietary period, man. I went right through that. I said, I was nice now. I ain't gonna lie.
How come you gonna get nice? You just put something different in your system.
I was nice though. I was like, you know, I was. You just be fully aware when you're out to make sense. Don't be fucking around in no car. You know, we are. Ain't something I ain't gonna do. I just did that one time. So I ain't gonna do that again. So we celebrated. Next time they have a little function. Oh no, youngsters, I'm cool, man. I'm drinking some water, man.
I'm all right. I might
take a glass of wine, but I ain't be doing them shots and shit.
Yeah, because they're trying to get their mind to another place, man. Not for no long period, just for right there, they're gonna be straight.
Boy, them young boys get when they get together, they have a nice time. I'll be laughing at them young folks.
You have a nice time, believe that.
But you know, man, it's refreshing, you know, because most of our family stuff on my kids and my brother kids is female dominated stuff.
Yeah.
It's fun to get around and see how these young dudes plan for stuff, man. Mm-hmm. I see back watching, man, they gonna do some kind of
yeah, because you gotta realize you can relate. That's why we say you need the balance of a man in a household when you got
that's
a
why, boy. That's why their kids gonna be good kids. Mm-hmm. They're gonna be fine, good. They're both them. Their daddies are. And like I said, DJ trying to get where, you know, at a certain point in time. And them boys wanna make a decision. They wanna live with their dad. They can. Mm-hmm. And I think if a kid gets to of age where he can think,
make a choice.
12 or 13 or 14. You wanna go live with your daddy? Because I mean, you see them growing up around about five, six other motherfuckers. It would be an environment where he can just work with both his boys.
Right.
And that's how he got, right now them boys got to deal with their little boys, and they got to deal with three or four motherfuckers that's older than them. You know, it's just like, you know, and then the oldest ones still coming through and in and out of the house, you know.
Older than not, it's tit for tat.
It is, man.
You just ain't getting to hear about it, bro. Yeah. It's tit for tat, bro.
And they the babies, but
you gotta look at the mama too, her aura. Yeah, it's tit for tat for me.
Yeah. I she love them kids, but she like the benefits that come from.
And not just that, Dave. She teach her kids to want the best of the shit. I guarantee you that.
Well, you know what? He don't mind giving them this shit.
Mm-hmm.
The way he is. He gonna give him drawers, he gonna get off, you know.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm just saying he gonna buy stuff. Yeah. But you know what? He bargain minds a motherfucker though. He ain't paying no top dollar for
nothing. I ain't gonna lie. I can see that nigga being one of the market shareholders, and that means shareholders.
That boy look at, yeah man, I got a good deal on this.
Yeah, I'm talking about Mark. When I say market share, that's when them dudes be underground buying shit.
He's good kid, man, but I mean, I told you, embrace that shit, man. Embrace it, shit. Have fun with it, shit. Let them ask shit. They need to know shit. They really need to know the truth. This is what I'm saying. Anytime you have a chance to sit there and tell somebody the truth, do it. Fuck this bullshit. Tell the motherfucking truth. Yeah, I'm in love with him, you know. I've always loved him, you know. And tell the fucking truth.
Why are you gonna beat around Bush when you're a grown ass adult?
I mean, you know, hey, Roscoe's gonna be fine. Roscoe will be fine.
Right, you're a grown ass man.
Grown man.
I said, that is time. He's
gonna hang on and linger on. And here's the thing, too, man. You gotta understand. He was in all the functions. He's in a place. You see all Roscoe's pictures? Now you can put my face in them. Just fucked up. You understand? No, and that's why I said, I told Lana, I said, all I want to know, when he gonna show up to shit, I might not show up. And I just told her.
And
I
mean, when you sit there and you think about
it. I'm gonna go through that shit.
If he don't know you just yet, even though I think he knows who you are. But I'm saying, if he don't
know. Oh, he know of me. He ain't seen me. But he went on my Facebook because he told her one time, he got two daughters, don't he?
Okay, so now I said this, but he don't know it's you, right wrong?
Hmm?
He don't know it's you. He don't know it's
you. Oh, no, he know. Yeah, but
okay,
I think.
I say this here.
I think he knows.
I say this. What you just said a few minutes ago about the picture change.
It's funny,
he ain't get to do that yet until he see you.
Shit, man, I pay attention to this shit. I said, you know, I said, my face is replacing him in pictures.
Bruh. Dude, when it really sets in, when he do lay eyes on you, yep, it ain't good for you to be around him. It ain't good to you be around him until he get a picture of you and him, her together. And then
he gotta get
a picture of that first.
Say, man.
You can't see the physical part of y'all two together and the aura of y'all two together without being in a picture first.
Because the aura of y'all being together,
no, you right there. That's your heart speaking on that one. Because the aura of y'all being together going to be overwhelming to him.
I don't know. Put it like this. You don't know how, and see, ain't shit jumped off yet until he's actually seen me and her in a function somewhere. If it's at some shit they was at a year ago.
It don't matter. Because like I said again, your heart is telling you, that's clear of all of it. It's telling you, nigga, you don't know what a person is going to do when they get in a situation of their emotions, which them seeing that this is the shit, and they feel how good y'all go together.
Oh, all you gotta see is her. All you gotta do is look upon her countenance. And remember the countenance he saw earlier on when he was with her, he gonna see somebody that's smiling, walking different, talking different, look happy, not sit up there, Morocco around, didn't have no smile on her face.
And then he see you.
And then he see me.
And then he see what you put in her, and his mind gonna go fucking.
Right? And my girl told me, she said, he'd been in heaven. He said that would just shit. But see, David, it got where it hurt.
It was hard.
She said, and I would tell him, 2 minutes, man. That's it. Wow.
Because her body wasn't giving the right juices off. All that shit, nigga. What it is, dog. That's fucked up. You're right, dude. He don't need to see you. You need to see a picture of you and her together and let him adjust that picture,
man.
And then take that picture in and process that picture for
Because this is something that's never happened to somebody. Yeah. I said, look, we're in an age now where motherfuckers just lose their mind for a second. Crime pattern.
And they got a gun.
Pow.
That second is fast. That's
fast. 61. I'll be 61 and 2. Mm-hmm. I'll be 61 in 13 days.
Fuck around like that. She's gonna hear this conversation.
I'm gonna tell her, I've been thinking about it. I said, well, I know y'all planning that major crawfish thing y'all do and everything. Because I don't want to eat that shit no way. But I said, look, I think that for me, if I know Roscoe's attending it, I won't be there.
Not right now.
I said, I just don't feel like. I said, look, let me tell you what's in the atmosphere.
Mm-hmm.
What's in the atmosphere?
Yes, that shit is.
I said, he hasn't gotten over you. Trust me on that. I said, and so. Everything is fine between you and I. I said, and this is what the spirits of the Most High God. The spirit of the Most High God was telling me, say, look, this situation here hasn't really jumped off yet, even though you and her have been doing things, blah, blah, blah. She got the divorce, boom, 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 boom. I said, things don't spark until the two main ingredients touch for the first time. It's
called ignite. They want to touch. Want Yo, touch
and the touch just might be a look. He see me and see you. And you happy.
Because it ain't going to be just the look.
And then to come around, all the folk he used to come around. Yeah,
Dave, it's too
and
much.
Now he's...
It's too much.
He's sitting over there smiling with that.
It's too much, bro.
He's in there. He's going to eat some food.
Bro, it's too much,
and
bro.
And he's sitting over
there. Dave.
And he's talking to them.
Dave.
That motherfucker.
Know how bad that is, Dave?
Shit, said,
let me tell you how bad that is, Dave.
Up in the house that I found and shit.
Dave, y'all at the gathering, Dave. Mm-hmm. He's sitting down eating his plate of food, Dave. And these two people here talking, Dave, but they don't know he's listening, Dave. And they left there and say, Elaine is looking so bright, and she look as happy as she ever was, ever in life. Dave, those type of shit fuck with a nigga that wasn't shit.
Hey, man. Every scenario that you can think of,
that war
has run away.
Oh, I know them too, but
I
know
this. And look, I don't have no fear.
No, I know.
Absolutely.
That's caution. I mean, that's caution.
I'm just
man.
Saying,
you
being
cautious.
Caution into the wind. Yep, I'm going caution. March is the windy month.
Mm-hmm.
It's the month when the wind blows a certain way. And when the wind blows in March, because that's
shit
my birth month. Oh, shit. That, man, it's my month.
Oh, wait, shit.
Ain't my birthday month, it's always their month.
Yeah, wait,
it's
my shit. Month. Wait, it's your month, then you ain't got to worry about it.
And so when things come up in the air, I'm just like, you know what? And guess what? And look, and it's really doing him a favor, too.
No, it's doing the atmosphere a favor, man.
The atmosphere, everything around in that motherfucker is doing right because,
like I said, fuck off anything, then everything will go back.
Because, but here, this to me.
All right.
This is what should happen if it's gonna happen. If he coming, somebody ought to tell him, well, Mama's date is gonna be there.
Mama's date is gonna be there.
She's gonna be with her new boo thing.
Her man gonna be there.
Well, that's what somebody tried.
A boo thing.
So somebody tried that TJ, and he told. He didn't say nothing. He said somebody from the church tried to say something, and he said, I said, all right, man, hey, all right, that's mom, you know, I don't know what's going on with that. He said, that's just why I'm playing out, that's mom, you know.
All right.
And then he texted and said, yeah, I wanted to tell him that's mom's boo thing from back in the day, but I didn't go there, you know. I said, yeah, that's good, I like that.
Mom's boo thing
from back in the day.
Yeah. Cause that's what you was from back in the day, the boo thing. You was the boo thing, nigga.
The boo thing.
Ain't no lie.
That's what was.
It ain't no lie. You was the boo thing.
That's real.
I said, that's real talk there, though.
That's like that, man.
That's life. I said that, that's hitting the nail on the head there, nigga. You was the boo thing, nigga. Y'all wasn't married.
And that's what Nikki texted her today. They were texting each other. And Nikki said something about, I said so. She said something in the text about y'all want to talk about mama's situational issues, and mom grown, and she said, and then Nikki said, well, I sense some sarcasm in what you say, laugh out loud, and I told her, I said, type this back to sarcasm is what sarcasm does.
Mm-hmm.
And boy, Nikki texts back, laugh out loud, I like that, mama. Start laughing. They just got good kids, man. They just concerned.
That's all it is, dog.
They just concerned.
You dig?
Cause mama looking like
a kid again.
Her style is getting so tall. She just loves the way her style is getting tall. You know,
tell her like Isaiah.
Her style just tossed the way she wants, man.
I was it.
She just like, yeah, you can't tell me nothing. She throws. They'll be talking, but I be like, mama grown, looking mama like in this. Full control of they, all of this.
They really.
I said, you really are. I said, because we in this, guess what I said, it's funny to me.
Get what I think about when I think about when you say that, though. I think about Baby Boy. When she said, mama kiss hers.
And then she looked, when she's looking at Green Rain, she said, yeah. Look at me. Like, so fuck shit. I'm gonna tear that nigga up. Like, well, I was like, what woman look at you like?
Yeah, dog.
Like, she looked at that nigga like, dog. Y'all don't put this pussy
yeah,
on me.
Yeah, dog. It ain't nothing like a woman looking at you like that, dog.
Don't put this pussy
like,
on me.
Nothing like a woman looking at you like that, boy. I mean, woo! It get chilled up your spine, boy.
She wasn't paying attention to the baby boy. She was just talking that. She was
looking at
your mama. Your mom, when she said,
in that garden,
she said,
your mama got knees too.
Mama got knees. That's what she said. And she put that cigarette
up. Yeah, dog.
Mama got knees too. Put that cigarette up. Looking at Ping Ping, man. Give me light that cigarette. Then Ping Ping walk around the house.
Yeah.
Boy, Ping always showed his ass, though. That goddamn nigga, I always show his motherfucking ass, though.
Bro, I told you, see, something happened in the jail, bro.
They got my son's ass, man. Yeah, we short shit. Oh, I ain't lifting shit. Are you crazy?
I have zero people watching. I don't know how nobody watching my show, but I can always go do my shit and laugh at my shit myself. Mm. But I'm like this here, Dave. What you just said, I remember when a woman picked me up, because you know I'm paralyzed, right?
Yeah.
And she said, I didn't know you were this heavy, and we fell on the floor. And she said, oh, you all right? I ain't break you or nothing. I said, we can finish right now. And look, had like a fan breaking off. She said, I thought I had broke something on you. I said, I ain't no fucking porcelain dog. Shit can't break nothing on me. But that's the trip, how we was athletic when we was athletic.
I remember your old pictures, though. You be spending your girls that ass. Pack out. Fuck, you shaking that ass. That should be hilarious. Somebody turn his whole fuck face. Todd has on fuck tapes, man. That was always one of your computers, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's on that one now. That's why I get that door to get out there. Look, that's one thing about that, Dave. You can tell a person a story like that, and a person can only do what? Go by your word, right? Because you wasn't expecting to see it. And
that
when I saw it, you
were... I'll never forget that. That image just etched in my mind, man. You smacking girls on the lab. Pop!
How about the one where the girl had my legs hitting the board, the headboard?
We came down here like the fool. Talking, you's a younger dude. You came down here like the motherfucking fool.
Oh, I told you, dog, you only live one time,
yeah,
boy.
You's in your 30s, so you can't act. You's acting the motherfucking fool up in this noise, boy.
But I ain't started really acting a fool in Houston, so I can't have the Katrina.
That's what I'm saying.
When I came out to Katrina, I ain't do a lot of fucking when I came out to Katrina. I just showed you like maybe about 1, 2, 3, 4 different holes I was fucking when I came out to Katrina.
Yeah.
Some other holes from my house, cause you can tell none of my shit was as clean as my motherfucking house was. Shit. my house had pussy on it. When the hole coming through the house, they just didn't see the fucking living room and be like, I might as well take my drawers off right here. Yes, you might as well. Let me run in there and go fix yourself and eat. You
move around real fast up in the wheelchair. I said, boy, when the person about to get some pussy as far as you are, nigga, move fast. It's like you don't have no feet. He said, I ain't have no fucking feet. But shit, bro. That was, but like I said again, I was nasty in New Orleans, bro. I had New Orleans locked up. I had fun. Come to this bitch here and just get fucked
up. Boy, there were about 700 TLC folk up in this hotel. It was standing room on. It was, boy, let me tell you something, man.
Y'all here in Houston,
huh? Yeah, there's a lot of lonely females in the city.
Man, I wish
I'm sitting
there
telling them,
man. Man, that bitch next time.
I'm sitting there telling them, man. I said, you know, what's it? The other thing's a marathon.
That's a shame.
It's a marathon. It's a marathon. You gotta be ready to sit up with your shit for a long time, because it goes long. It's a ceremony. It's just telling stories and shit. It's just, you know, people writing notes. It's like going to school. But, man.
They got some holes in there.
See that thing? And this was international. They had Korea.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
South America. They had France. They had South America. And Mexico. And man, they like to get down a totally different way at meetings. You know, because like I said, this is in business for yourself. And it's a little, I mean,
they get out of there.
They language and women then. Boy. I told him, I said, you know, I said, Joe, this is why I really want you to get into this business with me. I said, because I said, this is women driven. And I can help. Facilitate
what you do,
and then too, I said, I don't be in this. I said, because you seeing all these women. I said, look, in business, a man to be successful, he has to be able to talk.
Yep.
Who's gonna talk to most of the women? I said, you give me credibility, you help me out, boo, 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 boo. And that's how it worked. I said, because I ain't trying to get no pussy, but man. You need to be around so you don't think that's what's going on.
And not
just that. And I said that, I can be quiet. I just don't see what her reaction. And then she look at me and smile. Because these women don't really care.
I'm going to be honest with you, dude.
Man, women don't care.
I'm going to be honest with you, dude.
They don't, bro.
I'm going to be honest with you, dude. It wouldn't be, you see, and I say it's about you, and I think you already know that. Boy, it wouldn't be good for you to even try to go out there on your own.
Oh, no, man.
Why I say that, Del? Because as soon as you...
No, I want to do something to see if I can do the
key. Right, because see, if you go out there on your own, and another woman see you out there, if you out there on your own, guess how she going to pray on you? She going to pray on you being on your own, and she her helping you. Getting closer and closer to
you. Oh, shit, man, let that guy...
Done.
Done after that. This woman that came up with prayers and pastry the other day, her name and got
name. Noelle. She was trying to get you well, partner.
No, but you know, she was so damn friendly. You know, I was putting that battery in my car and shit. And I turned around, said, "Hi, how are you?"
Lovely.
And the,
your aura called her, did
you? And I looked at this woman, I'm like,
it called her.
Like, this is a nice woman.
It called
her. And I'm talking about, she didn't look slutty. She just had a pleasant look about her. And she's trying to get folk come to her church.
Okay.
And I sat there and I said, give me some information. And then she opens up her trunk and gives me those cupcakes. I said, you mind if I pray with you? Come on, let's pray. And then she, I ain't say nothing about what I was and gives nothing. I just like to be real. I don't see how real they're gonna be. But y'all can tell me what you're about later.
Always.
I don't see how real she's gonna be.
Always.
And then she gives me the pastries. I said, "Prime pastries." And she grinned. I said, "That's powerful." Mm-hmm. And you pray for somebody and give them some sweets.
Some sweets.
I ain't never gonna forget.
And then chocolate, that.
And then I said, so what's your name again? I said Naomi. She said, Noelle. I said, Noelle. I said, like the first Noelle. Yeah, she said, I'm the second one. I said,
Woo!
That's a song we learned.
She was
the first Noelle.
She was the second.
The angel did say. So I said, like the first Noelle. She said,
she was flirting.
She said, no, flirting too. She said, I'm the second. I said,
I'm flirting too. The aura, boy. The aura pulled that granite group.
You know, they mouth pulling up.
And there she was, waiting to get into the gate. She said, what's the gate code? I walked up, said, hey, what's going on? She said, yeah. So I'm sure like you come to our church on Sunday. I said, Tim, I got an engagement to go to. So I said, you gave me the information. I got down. I'm going to pay you a visit on Sunday. Okay? So that's nice. It's nice. So I gave her gate code. And then the other day, I pull up to the door. There's the bread. I threw that bread out, which is it's a big old hard piece of motherfucking wheat, long motherfucking wheat bread. And then I started, the mold got on that motherfucker. Because, hey, look, I ain't lose. Hey, bread is one thing you don't fuck with when you're in a dietary, trying to maintain a dietary posture. You can't fuck with bread, and that's one thing you don't fuck with.
That other thing is form of bread.
No, I fuck with whole grain. That was wheat, but it just, see, I like the whole grain got more shit in than just wheat. I want other stuff.
Because whatever that what they call it now, croissants, what is that made out of? Because it ain't made out of no wheat.
There's some wheat in it, but then there's some other, I mean, you know, it's
something holding together.
You know, flour and...
That's what it is. It's the flour that fucking you up.
Yeah, you know, man. So that's where that going, man. That shit came on the door free. I don't know what the fuck. I think, man, I cut that motherfucker in half, put it on the grill, and that butter,
man,
put some jelly on it.
Boy,
you
saw how it melted. I almost melted your mouth.
Man, yeah, put jelly on it, put a little peanut butter. That's good,
man. Man, I think that first one that I knocked out, dog, that bitch was all. That bitch was
dynamite. What people like to do is put meat in there. You know, folk like
yeah, 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 yeah.
Put meat in
there. I'll put my salad in there.
Put an egg in that motherfucker. With some sausage, some bacon. You got a croissant.
Yeah. But anyway, that thing was so soft. Me eating with my salad and the corn chips and after the corn chips were gone, I was eating the rest of my salad. And then the rest of it was just so good. And then the next day, I said, what the fuck? I mean, everything was stopped up. And I said, I didn't think what could have possibly stopped me up. And I said, nah, that was too good to be gonna stop me up.
Yeah, saying,
and then I said to myself, we gonna see. Dave, I hit that, you saw it. I ain't even eat a lot of that croissant, huh? Mm-hmm. Nigga, I ate that croissant that like, little bitch, I was just taking little bites off it. Little bites off, because I ate like half of it. I took little bites off it. And as I was taking bites off, it almost like I felt like crying, because that's because someone was getting better and better and better, and I was getting stopped up and stopped up and stopped up more. And I said, oh, fuck that shit. That's what did it. And when they say sometimes some shit that you think is good for you ain't.
Oh, yeah, well, that was true, but you just watch your breads.
Right, now, watch bread. Like I said, I got to watch bread, period. Yeah. I know now. Because like I said, I'm fighting this shit now, dog. Look, it's shitty, but I know that's what it is.
Watch breads.
Because I can't run that shit. Now, that shit
the
need to be
run. The whole grains are good because it got fiber, which melts your shit.
Mm-hmm.
Fiber, you know.
See, and right now, I don't have nothing to help me shit but that ladder load, but all it's doing is caking everything up. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And it's not coming out liquidy, and I don't want to get none of that, what they call that dumb shit, electric glycerin bullshit, because I don't want to be no water around this bitch and shit like that. So I just got to suffer with the shit coming out like ice cream.
Get some tea, man. Get some tea.
See, but like I'm saying, none of it is getting this stack. See, because the tea is for to clean you, right?
Detox.
It's for the detox, right?
Yeah.
But how can it detox you when I'm already detoxing with the other stuff, with the
it's helping make, you know, but it's soft and shit.
And that's what I'm saying. It's soft.
Shit.
You heard me? Right now it's soft and it's coming out, but it's coming out real, real slow because I don't walk. You got me?
Yeah.
And the shit is irritating because it's hurting. You know, I'm supposed to feel this shit, but I feel my body waking up. You dig? Cause like, on my legs and shit, I'm moving real bit.
Life is funny though. I'm enjoying.
Come on.
I'm enjoying the ride.
And like again, and that ride is not enjoyable unless it's two. You and somebody else. Somebody you love.
That's really true, man. You know, and I think a lot of people. It's hard for people to embrace other folks' journey. Like we were at the convention we was at. I was able, the first half I had to sit on the floor. Couldn't let the ladies have the chairs.
Oh, you know that. You know that. So, what a man.
But it's still not enough. There's still women that had to stand. I mean, it was just that packed.
What do you think gonna jump off then?
They ended to win. They built organizations. They hustled. They had it every day, every second, every hour. I mean, you got motherfuckers just working the shit. And then you got some working very part-time, but they persistent at what they do. But so the second half, I got a chair set behind her. And she and I were talking and everything. And so the guy sitting next to me, and the girl that was next to him, she comes, she attends some of the meetings that we have, and she said, yeah, he said, yeah, I'm talking about another organization. I was in. He said, I was in that too, man. Mm-hmm. He's a personal trainer. This is a personal trainer. And he said, my girl came to me, man, and told me, sell this product and detoxing and also losing weight. And I saw it, man, this face is looking good. You know, we got hooked up, we've been dating everything. He said, so Lane turned back and he said, Henderson Lane to himself, to him to Lane. And Lane already knew the other day, like, from the meeting. And I said, yeah, I said, this is my girlfriend now, but she's gonna be my wife in the future. He said, yeah, man, speak it, man. I told you, it's spoken, brother. No. And the girl turned big over and said, oh, yeah, it's gonna be my wife. I said, yeah, for real. So that's some nice stuff. How long have you known each other? I said, 1979. I said, we both divorced and everything, and come back again. He said, oh, that's so romantic. That's what you see women. That's romantic to women. So that's so romantic.
Because it's almost like the truth is being revealed.
But the whole thing, the thing I told Raymond said, do you know? I said, relationships like ours will help people.
Right. Yeah. Grow.
I said, it'll give people hope and, you know, second chances. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of people run to folks years later, and you're not going once it happens. Somebody you met 10, 15, 20, 30, whatever your story is, years ago, you ain't seen him for a minute. But when you all were hooked up at whatever point in time, like you hooked up and it was good and it was perfect. Because this woman you was with at one point in time in life, when you were at that moment in time, y'all were perfect together. It was like, shit, this is fire here. This woman is special. I said, everybody got that one person, if they could go back. I said, I'll even say, man, don't give up on second chance. Don't give up. Hey, if you can find a neighbor social media, you can find folk. I'm serious. Do you know social media is helping people reunite all over the world, man? The world.
Let me tell you something about what they call it, your soulmate. It's really... You don't control who your heart falls in love with if you never met them before, or you lay up there and been knowing them and never got a chance for you to talk to them.
Hey, man, that's right. Yep.
You did.
That's what I said, man. I know this, that don't give up. No search for love. Yep. This one artist said, don't give a search for love. It's worth the wait.
Come on, dog. Because you got...
Hey, man. And you know, your prayer come at a time, man, when you're young enough to do something. Woo! 70. But you finally get to 70, though. Shit.
Hey.
Technically,
nigga,
I mean...
Nigga, if you get to 75, be happy, nigga.
Sitting here for me... I've been pursuing Lane. It's 8 years. You take 8 from 60. 52. I was 52 years old. When I moved to Houston in 2008, My mother tripped out when she finally. So you moved to Houston? How you doing in Houston? So I've been living in Houston for like a year, Ma. Man, so you all right? Yeah. What?
You talking about my mom, but I'm in a wheelchair. I can understand my mama saying that. You grown ass motherfucking man, but your mama, she got you realize. I realize who your mama is. Your mama is a sweetheart too.
Well, then too, you know, nigga, you always been married, always have somebody,
got somebody to help you.
To help you,
yep.
To help you, you know, to help me.
And once again,
now you're out there sitting by yourself.
Mama know that you need your better half to balance.
Hey man, I mean, look, man, having a woman in your life. Let me tell you something, bro. See, that's the thing. Having a woman in your life, man. That care about you and don't mind giving you what she has. That's special. And then she know that you're going to do everything you can to make sure you reciprocate. I ain't talking about payback, reciprocate.
I reciprocate.
You share what you have with her.
Yep.
You have to share it back. You got to give it back.
Got to give it back. It's like a fucking just call forward.
It's just giving. You just can't receive. Bullshit, man. Like, you know,
that ain't a real man. That's some old nigga that want to be a get over.
I can understand children's concerns, but they both had a dose of me. But this last weekend, they had to leave from that them two young ones because they don't the older one, you know, they don't really share with him. But the two had to leave from that thing. Said, well, mama sure look happy.
Cause I can say about it, that daughter is all that daughter can do is see her mama and envy.
I'm sitting across from her, and man, I'm just looking right at me. I'm like, no, kind of just turning away. She's trying to analyze what it is. Mama said, right now, mama. And I know mama basically hanging on you like old schoolgirl.
Am I wrong?
Yeah, mama.
Yep.
And mama doing stuff. She would never. So she would never serve him a plate and stuff like that. Give him a plate, and give him a plate. So I made sure at this I got my plate. Cause she be quick to give me plates. So I get your plate. We have a plate. I get your plate. Oh God, I got it. I want to be making them distinctions. I got 26-year-old kid. I'm just trying to present just a smooth kind. Hey, look, your mom into me and I'm into her, so it is the way it is, yeah. You know. And she told me, she says, so I called you. She called me to get directions. I said, oh, I'm sorry. I said, I had my phone on. Yeah, that football game that we went to was a lot of fun. I said, it was special for me too. It was fun.
It was a different you out there by yourself. You was out there with somebody you care about.
With her family.
You with everybody.
Yeah, and
vibing.
She saw how
divine.
Excited, much fun her mom was having. Mom was just, outside, knocked my glass off one time because dude scored a touchdown. I said, boy, you done fucked up in there. My ass is getting all emotional. Still the game. We all kind of got excited because the cold, man, about 30. I got down to about 38 degrees out there, man. Cold as nuts. But hey, man, they had blankets and stuff and was cheering for the team. And my good time, man, I had a good time. I was like, hold me, bitch, but have my shit on. Yep. I had a good time, man. And one thing about got some beer. So I'm not really into drinking, but I'm
going to crack a few.
I'm a social drinker.
I'm a social drinker.
So we was at the Super Bowl. Party at this guy's house. Al. Nicky said, drinking with the day? I said, yeah, you know I'm a social drinker. Start laughing. She said, you know I'm a social drinker. It's a social occasion.
Yeah.
I'm a drinker. Just start laughing. So it reminds me, man, you told me you get this a little bit. She's funny, man. That's a hilarious child.
Now, remember what I told you about that medallion that I had?
Yeah.
Nah, this was the back.
Yeah.
And this was the piece that was in the middle with my name on it, Mr. John Norton. And I said, that brings back memories.
Gold, said, silver?
Platinum.
What happened to
him? Pawn shop. What happened? I just want to say, what happened to everything when hard times come around?
Yeah,
that shit got to go. What it called? I call it collateral.
Yep.
He did, because yep. That's one thing about that debt. It was like money.
Oh, yeah, man. Shit.
It was like money. But boy, yeah. I would love to have it back, boy.
Cause how much money you get for it?
$500? Nah, man, I got on one point that thing. I got $2,000-$3,000 for that thing. That thing cost me like almost
$80,000.
And they said, the value on that there broke down once all that gold was melted and the diamonds was put on here and the holes was put in. I said, well, the platinum was going to still melt down to the solid platinum. But that's all I'm getting for it.
You paid $8,000
for it. In over, like I said, not even a 4-year period of time, it devalued. And we both know that gold, precious metals don't do that. But when a motherfucker see you in a desperate state, you take advantage.
You should have took something like that one
of them. But then it was drug dealers on lay up there and this is when I was walking, man. This is when I was in a drug game, nigga. Shit. Motherfucking platinum had just not hit the motherfucking. Nobody know nothing about no platinum, man. Fuck. That was like your boy, what that boy name is? Wearing that fucking shirt, coat, and that hat. You dig?
Yeah.
Shit. But I'm gonna get that piece made again, but I'm getting made in like the Mardi Gras shit. That plastic? Oh yeah. And it's gonna be a nice piece to watch. I just gotta find the people that do the plastic. I'll find them on the internet. Yeah, though, ain't nothing like seeing happiness. Ain't nothing like seeing happiness.
Oh yeah, bro. Yeah. Yeah.
Cause it can't help but feel it.
Yeah, when your mama happy.
Yeah, all right, bro.
I know mama happy. My mama know I'm happy.
I told you that y'all like little teenagers.
What's cooking?
And when you hook me up a set, I can do it out in carrots.
I've sent the collection point to your GPS. Make the pickup and bring the goods to the warehouse. Huh? Should be straightforward.
Oh, all right. I got you now. All kind of shit. And that's what I see when I saw it in that zinc. I see that's gonna bring roaches.
Huh? Yeah.
Having a conversation with my daughter, we're talking about careers. What she's doing in the insurance business. She works in the insurance company. She works with learning claims, all different forms of the insurance business from, you know, the back end of the insurance business, not the front end. So really most seriously, because they, should happen. And yeah, nice discussion. I just seen this. Listen to a young lady talk, and listen to a young woman talk. That ain't your child. It's intriguing.
Yeah, yeah. Especially when you know they listen to you.
You know, and she was just into the conversation. Man, saying, "This young girl, she's listening, man." I said, "That's the age they have, man."
Yeah, because they want to know. They do.
She's from Louisiana. You want
South Mel? I'm just saying.
You just saying when you make it South, right. No carrots. What they do to you?
And then they would help him with that fuck. They would help him with that with that bakery shit.
Oh.
Anytime I want, I can stop and make them shit ass up. I'm just trying to make this shit look as TV as I can possibly make it look. When I'm doing my documentary, or what I do as far as the show.
Yeah,
because
you
got to
make sure you
got
that
good
quality
shit.
You
got to
make sure you got
that good
quality
shit. Especially with the bullshit happening with jail. The police lying on me. At Walmart. Put me in jail for standing up for myself and being a racist. Place where the fuck the return pods. I heard that girl, oh Jesus. That really fucked loud. Come through. I see you on a motorcycle, son. Ooh. Shit, I have one more set of y'all coming up here for this thing. Oh, well, too late. I don't know if I'm coming up here for damnation. I'm at my destination. 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 I'm Mr. Dad, the truth is the truth, period. Fuck all the bullshit. And I just did this thing with y'all of my life. On the big screen, telling the truth, cause you know what I mean. I love you more than you love you, cause I know the truth and you don't. I'm here to tell you the truth, so you know the truth for yourself. Love and light. Light is love. And light, as a feather, is love. Light is heaven.